With the introduction of Mahinda Chintana Forward Mission, President Mahinda Rajapaksa laid down several strategies to transform Sri Lanka to be the miracle of the Asian region. And to talk about the whole economic drive, the economic program of Sri Lanka and the economic situation of Sri Lanka, on this edition of Crossfire, an exclusive production of the Government Information Department, we have with us Professor ADVDS Indraratna, President of the Organization of Professional Associations of Sri Lanka. He's also the Emeritus Professor of Economics at the University of Colombo and President of the Sri Lanka Economic Association. Welcome, Professor.
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me to this program.
You're welcome.
Well, let us start from about 2005, when Mahinda Rajapaksa took over as the president of this country. Well, from 2005 to 2008 and first half of 2009, he faced several problems. One was the intensification of the war, terrorist war. Then there was the recession, which came towards the latter part of 2008, world recession.
Yeah.
Although it had not much impact on Sri Lanka, all the same, it had some impact. So, going through all these things, and also in addition to those, there were the soaring food prices and prices of oil, and
inflation.
Inflation. And he had to face all these. Despite all that, 2005 to 2008, we achieved a very respectable rate of economic growth.
Mm-hmm.
On the average, about 6.7%.
Mm-hmm.
Then, of course, the 2009, first half of 2009, we faced the impact of the recession, world recession, and the growth rate, which was very high previously, during the preceding 3 years, came down to about first quarter 2009, 2001.5, and ended up with an average of 3.5, which is almost half of what it was in the preceding 3 years.
Yeah.
So then, of course, this was the height of the war at this time, but by 2009, May 19, he finished the war.
Hmm.
But with the end of the war, there were several challenges faced by the government. Challenges as well as opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
What are the challenges? Challenges for resettlement of the IDP, internally displaced people.
Yeah.
Challenges of building up the infrastructure, which had been completely destroyed in the North and East.
The restoration of peace.
Restoration of peace, and also the connectivity, bring the whole country together, increase connectivity intra-regionally, North and East, and also inter-regionally, the connectivity was necessary. These were the challenges he had to face. While facing, of course, with these challenges, there were tremendous opportunities also at the end of the war. One was the liberation of one-third of the land of the country.
Yeah.
One-third of the land was liberated completely.
Mm-hmm.
Two-thirds of the sea coast with all the aquatic and marine resources of the country.
Yeah.
Which was, then, of course, there was a tremendous potential of human resources,
mm-hmm,
because the fighting forces now released from the battlefront,
yeah,
were available for the peacetime work.
Yeah.
And which, of course, most of them are now engaged in that sort of work. So with these opportunities were used by the government. They started on permanent infrastructure with Naginira Dhane and Uturu Vasanthaya, then Maganaguma, Gamanaguma program and all that. And now by this time, for instance, IDPs, almost 90% of them have been completely settled.
Mm.
And there is peace. Eh? And a lot of people, as you know, that the increased connectivity between the north and the south. In the north itself, the A9 road has been opened. Traffic is moving. So there is tremendous opportunities now have been created, not only for domestic development, but also for foreign investment to come in and develop the external sector.
Yeah, so that's one point I want to stress, Professor, about the foreign investments and how we can project ourselves now with the war coming to end, especially to the foreign people. And Tamil diaspora, they also play a huge role because a lot of money is there with the Tamil diaspora. They also can come in and invest in a lot of parts in Sri Lanka. How do you see this happening? How
yes.
we can project ourselves?
Now, of course, The war has ended, of course, about 15 months ago. Peace has been restored. Infrastructure is being created. That is the creating the environment for foreign investment or local investment to come in for increased investment. That has been there. But still, there seems to be a certain amount of caution on the part of the people. Mm. Although we have created, we have all strong economic fundamentals, very strong economic fundamentals. There is a low inflation. You know, the inflation, which was 28.2% in 2008 June, has come down around 5% now.
Yeah.
5% now. And it is stable at that level. So which is a low inflation regime. Interest rates have come down. Interest rates which are around 20% has come down to about 8%, 9% today. Treasury bill rate is less than 8%.
Yeah.
So low in interest regime. Now these are very prerequisites for increased investment.
Mm-hmm.
And there is political stability. There's a government with 2/3 majority, which we didn't have for the last so many years.
Yeah.
So now, of course, foreign investment is coming, but not sufficiently. I think people are still waiting till the president takes over the next 6 years office, and then with this increase with the passing of the 18th Amendment, there'll be tremendous authority and power given to the government to forge ahead.
Yeah.
With the development program and so on. So I think. It will, you know, you can't expect him to spurt in a big way suddenly. While the people are, the investors are watching the situation. Now, as that is why even our foreign reserves have increased beyond 6 billion,
mm.
6 billion, which is sufficient for more than 6 months of imports.
Yeah.
So the now the tourism is increasing. Tourism has, tremendously expanded with more than 50% increased tourist arrivals.
Yeah. But Professor, all those improvements are there. Do you think that the ground realities, in fact, the infrastructure and the grassroots levels are there to accommodate all these foreign investments in a proper way? For an example, the state sector. Is our state sector in a position to cope up with all these new developments and changes?
Yes. Well, there are certain shortcomings, true. We must have a strong public sector. We must have an efficient, independent public service. We must have. Then we must have strong institutions.
Hmm.
We must have strong institutions because for that our communication, energy, all that sectors will be able to assist the